HarperCollins presents Without a Trace by Jane Bettany. Read by Helen Keeley. Chapter 1. The rain was relentless, cold and spiteful. Its stinging wetness slapped at Ruth Prendergast's face as she dashed from her car towards the shelter of the porch. After putting down the groceries she was carrying, she pulled a key from a pocket, unlocked a front door, and hurried inside. A warm, centrally heated fog closed around her as she stepped into the hallway. Ruth felt for the light switch and flicked it on, glancing censoriously at the scuffed paintwork and gloomy wallpaper. First impressions were important, and her hallway was definitely letting the side down. After yanking a handful of junk mail from the teeth of the letterbox and hanging up her coat, she threw open the double doors to the living room and turned on more lights to brighten things up. Except for the ticking, clicking sound of the central heating radiators, the silence in the house was absolute. Ruth had moved to Hollybrook Close 3 weeks earlier and was struggling to adjust to the suburban seclusion of her new home. Weirdly, she missed the constant buzz of the traffic-infested main road, where until recently she had lived with the man who was now her ex-husband. At the end of the hallway, the kitchen door stood open. She went in and turned on the oven, threw her house keys into the half-empty fruit bowl, and went back to retrieve the shopping bags from the porch. Most evenings she enjoyed cooking a meal for one from scratch, something wholesome and tasty. But today's dinner would be a ready-made pizza and a large glass of Chardonnay. She'd had a long and vile day at work, made worse by the tedious and tiring trek around the supermarket on her way home. All afternoon she'd been unable to shake off a restless, empty feeling. She felt dull and lacklustre, her vitality jaded by yet another dreary January day. Ruth was a summer person, and she yearned for the end of March, when the clocks would go forward into British summertime. Bring it on, she thought. Light nights, sunny days, warm breezes. She could do with some of that. Shivering involuntarily, she began to unpack the groceries. It was a loathsome but necessary chore, albeit one that was slightly easier these days, thanks to the abundance of cupboard space and a new kitchen. When the last items of shopping had been stashed away, she unwrapped the pizza, slid it into the oven, and set the timer before going upstairs with an armful of toiletries. The silence moved with her, creeping through the house like a virus. In the bathroom, Ruth caught sight of herself as she crammed shampoo and toothpaste into the narrow, mirrored cabinet next to the wash basin. She looked a wreck. Wet from the rain, a fringe clung to her forehead unattractively. There was no getting away from it. She'd have to blitz it with the air dryer, possibly even the straighteners. As she crossed the landing to her bedroom, the shriek of an animal pierced the night air. The sound was coming from the field directly behind Hollybrook Close. The cul-de-sac was on the northern edge of Bainbridge, wedged incongruously between the bustle of the lively market town and a vast expanse of open countryside. At night, it was eerily quiet here, and she found the seclusion unnerving. Would she ever get used to living in semi-isolation? Leaving her husband, getting a new job, and moving to a different town was supposed to have been a fresh start. But she wasn't convinced this house would bring the contentment she longed for. Ruth didn't bother turning on the main light as she went into the bedroom. Its yellow glow was too harsh and made her look jaundiced. Instead, she reached across to switch on the cozier, more flattering lamp on the bedside cabinet. That's when she saw the man, lying in her bed.
What the? She leapt away, scrabbling for the main light switch. Who the hell are you? When he didn't reply, Ruth leaned over and prodded him tentatively. But still he didn't move. Her heart banged a warning against the inside of her ribcage. Instinct told her to flee, to hurry from the house and get help. But who could she call? She didn't know any of the neighbours yet, and she had no friends in the area. There was her ex, of course. But he lived miles away and they weren't exactly on speaking terms. The man was clearly in a deep sleep, tucked under the duvet with his back to her. Ruth reached out and touched his shoulder, shaking it gently to wake him.
When he didn't respond, she tiptoed around the bed and looked down at the unfamiliar contours of his face, at the thick waves in his graying hair and the kink in his nose. It was the way he was staring that chilled her bones. His eyes were green, unblinking. That's when she knew. The man in her bed was dead. Chapter 2. The last thing D.I. Isabel Blood needed right now was a murder investigation. She was supposed to be taking 2 weeks' leave, for God's sake, spending time with her father, who, aside from a few recent conversations on FaceTime and Skype, she hadn't seen for decades. Isabel was on her way to pick him up at the airport when the call came through from D.S. Fairfax. "We have a body," her sergeant told her. "An unidentified male, found in a property in Hollybrook Close in Bainbridge. The homeowner found him lying in a bed. She doesn't know who he is and there's no ID on the victim. Sounds like a weird one, boss." Isabel pulled up in front of the barrier at the entrance to the airport's short-stay car park. "Bloody hell, Dan. The timing couldn't be worse. I'm at East Midlands Airport meeting my dad." She wound down the car window and snatched at the ticket that was spewing out of the machine. "I realise that. I'm sorry, I didn't want to call. But the super insisted. She's cancelled all leave. Wants you at the scene, apparently." For crying out loud, Isabel thought. "All I want is a bit of peace and quiet and some time off. Is that too much to ask?" When the barrier lifted, she took a deep breath and drove on, scanning the car park for a space. "Are you at the scene yet?" she asked. "I've just arrived." "Okay. Well, you'll have to start without me, and I'll join you as soon as I can. It's going to be at least an hour, though. More likely, an hour and a half." As she parked, she talked through the main priorities and actions with Dan, knowing she could rely on him to manage things until she got there. Once the call had ended, she leapt out of the car and raced towards the airport building. Her dad's plane had already landed. He'd be through passport control by now, reclaiming his baggage. She wanted to be in place, waiting, when he came through into the arrivals area. She was nervous, jittery, eager to see him and yet shy, embarrassed. Until a few months ago, Isabel had been totally in the dark about her father's whereabouts. He'd walked out of her life when she was 14, and Dad effectively disappeared. In the midst of her last murder investigation, she'd found out he was alive and well, and living in France. She'd also discovered why he'd left all those years ago. That revelation had left the two of them with a few things to work out. Their reunion was destined to have some awkward moments, but even so, Isabel couldn't wait to see him. Inside the arrivals area, she stood shoulder to shoulder with other waiting relatives. A gaggle of taxi drivers had congregated nearby, holding up cardboard signs with surnames scrawled across them. A heady combination of excitement and apprehension was making Isabel feel sick. She took some deep breaths as she waited, trying to suppress her anxiety. When the sliding glass doors from the customs area opened, and she saw her dad walk through, her heart rate thundered into overdrive. Donald Corrington looked exactly as she remembered him, but older, much older. His hair was white now, but at least he still had hair. He'd always been tall and lanky, but age had stooped him a little, and he was thinner, a fraction too skinny. There was a frailness about him that tugged at her conscience. The pale blue, shining eyes she remembered from childhood were scanning the crowd, searching for her. Waving, Isabel pushed forward. "Dad!" She surged through the crowd, desperate to reach him. "Over here! Dad, I'm here!" And then there he was, standing right in front of her. Her dad. Her lovely, lovely dad.
"Isabel."
His voice was thick with emotion as he gathered her into his arms.
"It's wonderful to see you at last. I've missed you so much."
She closed her eyes and clung to him, feeling like a kid again. Holding on tight, she breathed in the smell of his aftershave, refamiliarizing herself with the forgotten contours of his shoulders and the comforting warmth of his embrace. This hug, this moment felt like coming home. Swallowing the lump in her throat, she pulled back and smiled up at him.
I've missed you too, Dad.
More than you'll ever know. We've got a lot of catching up to do. It was as they stepped apart that Isabel noticed the man hovering behind her father's right shoulder. He was tall and slim, with brown hair, pale blue eyes and the hint of a swagger. Nostalgia pounded from somewhere deep inside her ribcage. This was a younger version of her dad. The man he'd been all those years ago. Instinctively, Isabel knew this must be her younger brother, Fabian. Her half-brother. What was he doing here? She hadn't been expecting him. The man extended his arm, shaking her hand briefly.
I'm Fabian, he said. I've heard a lot about you.
Isabel got the impression he'd chosen his words carefully, avoiding the social niceties normally used on such occasions. There was no, it's good to meet you, or it's a pleasure to make your acquaintance. Then again, Fabian was French. Perhaps his English didn't run to such stiff British phraseology. She couldn't help wondering, though, whether his greeting had been purposefully cool. There was no kiss on either cheek. No warmth, French or otherwise.
Hello, Fabien, she said, her voice friendly and cheerful. Bonjour et bienvenue, enchanté.
Having exhausted her repertoire of suitable French greetings, she added,
This is a surprise. I didn't know you were coming as well.
Why was he here? Had Fabien come along solely to support their elderly father on his journey? Would he be flying back almost immediately, or did he plan on staying? Isabel had readied the spare room for her dad, but she hadn't anticipated a second visitor. Not that it was a problem. She could quite easily install the put-me-up bed in the small upstairs room they now used as a study, as long as Fabien didn't mind roughing it a little. Her father was holding her hand, squeezing it tightly as if to reassure himself she was real. She squeezed back, her heart thumping in her chest. Feeling uncharacteristically flustered, Isabel eyed the two enormous suitcases Fabien was dragging behind him.
They look heavy, she said. My car's over in the car park. Would you like me to drive it round to the pickup point?
Her father tugged her hand playfully.
Don't worry. I'm sure Fabien can find a luggage trolley from somewhere. And I'm still quite capable of walking, you know. I may be over 80, but I'm not completely clapped out.
S'il te plaît, papa, said Fabien. Laisse-la chercher la voiture.
I have no intention of letting your sister get the car,
Donald said, rebuking his son with a tap on the arm.
And Fabien, please speak English. Isabel may be one quarter French, but her knowledge of the language is rudimentary at best.
While Fabien went off in search of a trolley, Isabel and Donald stepped aside and waited on the concourse with the cases.
So, Dad? She turned to face him. Have you told Fabien yet? Does he know?
Donald Corrington shrugged nonchalantly.
The right opportunity hasn't arisen, he said.
Since reconnecting with her father 2.5 months earlier, Isabel had been mindful that her 2 half-brothers knew nothing about the bigamous marriage Donald had entered into with Isabel's mother back in the 60s. Donald had promised to tell his sons the truth when the time was right, but she was beginning to wonder when that would be.
You're putting me in an awkward position, she said, rebuking him with a frown. I want to be able to talk about things openly. That's not going to be possible if Fabien still doesn't know the full story of your old life in Derbyshire.
Donald fiddled with the handle of the suitcase, reluctant to return her gaze.
I realise that, but I didn't think he was going to accompany me. He waited until I was checking in for the flight to announce he was coming along.
Why did he leave it until the last minute to tell you?
Donald held up his hands.
He said he wanted it to be a surprise.
I see, Isabel said, not sure whether she did or not. I wonder why he decided to join you.
Her father looked uneasy, his loyalty seemingly torn.
Perhaps he wanted a chance to get to know his sister.
He opened his mouth to say more, but closed it when Fabien reappeared, pushing a trolley with a wonky wheel. Remembering the phone call from Dan, Isabel decided to bite the bullet and break the news that she had been called into work. She cleared her throat.
Dad? Fabien? Before we get going, there's something I need to tell you. Unfortunately, I've got to go to work this evening. I'll drop you off at my house, introduce you to Nathan, Ellie and Kate and get you settled.
but then I'll have to go out for a while. I'm really sorry. It's a hazard of the job, I'm afraid. There's been a murder, and when that happens, I'm expected to drop everything. But you haven't seen our father.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.